Hi, this is a video clip for Bayesian data analysis course. In this clip, I talk about observation model, likelihood, posterior, and as an example, I use binomial model. Last time I talked about flipping a coin and also taking chips out of the bag, either red or yellow. And in these cases, we can think that now the probability of event one, which could be probability of heads or probability of red chip in a trial is theta. And one trial is then when I take one chip out of the bag, what is the probability that it's red? And I put it again, another trial, and I took another chip. And now each of these trials, they are independent, and we have some probability which depends on how many red and yellow chips I have in the bag. And so probability of red chip would be now theta. Probability of yellow chip is then 1 minus theta. So in a binomial model, we have just two different events which might happen, and there's uncertainty then which one happens next. If there's a sequence of these events, and these are independent trials, based on the probability calculus, we can combine these probabilities by multiplying them. And so if we get red, it's theta, times red, theta. We get yellow, times 1 minus theta, and so on. And we get the sequence of these probabilities, and we can combine them. Now, if we are interested only in the total, how many red chips we picked up totally, when we repeated this many times, we can summarize this by then combining all the theta terms. So we have theta to exponent y, which is now our number of red chips, and then y minus theta exponented to n minus y, which is then the number of yellow chips. Now, if you don't care about the what is the order of these chips, we care only about how many of them were red and how many of them yellow, we then include also all the possible combinations which could have explained this number of red chips, but we don't care about the sequence. And so this term here is now then the binomial combinatorial term n over y, and it tells all the possible combinations given we have n trials and y of them were red. And then we get, if we know the probability of red and we know how many trials we had, we have probability for each y, each number of reds we might pick up. So let's see an example. So here I just repeated the equation for this our observation model, which describes the uncertainty, what kind of observations we might see if we have make n trials. The first case is we have just one trial, and if it would be coin flipping, it would be theta would be half, and then there would be equal probability of observing zero heads or one heads. If we keep flipping this coin many times, 10 times, you can see now there's variation in how many times we might see theta. It's most likely to see 5, but there's quite a lot of probability mass combined also for the other options. And so there's the variability, what we might see if we flip a coin 10 times. Then the theta might be something else. So if we would have here much more reds than yellows, and if the theta would be 0.9, and we would pick 10 times a chip, then it would be more likely to get these high count values and very unlikely to get very low count values. So far, we have been describing with this model this aleatoric uncertainty observation model or statistical model for the events if we know the model and the model parameter. Then we can now use a Bayes rule to find out the other way around. What if we know the number of observations? Let's get back in this. We think about that here the theta was half, and we would now observe 8 redshifts. You can look at the what is the height of the bar here for the 8, or what is the bar height here for the 8. So we can see that it's more likely that theta would be 0.9. Instead of just comparing these two options, we can compute how likely 8 redshifts would be for each possible theta. In Bayes rule, so here was the term which looks like our observation model, but if we fix the number of redshifts we saw and instead vary theta, then this is called likelihood. We have a prior, we have something which is just a normalization term. So this, what we have below, it's just the integral, what we had above. It has some other meanings sometimes, but we come back to them much later. And then on the left-hand side, we have the uncertainty about theta described by the probability distribution for theta. Now for the simplification, we start using uniform prior. I'll come back later to priors. But now we just said this is a uniform and the theta is constrained to be between 0 and 1 as it's this probability. And then, so the prior drops, we have what we had previously, those terms we had in our observation model also. We have the normalization term. When we integrate that, it doesn't depend anymore on theta, and our posterior distribution is there's some normalization term, and then there are these terms. And that now, this is a function of theta. And then the y and n would be fixed here. In case of this binomial distribution, it happens that we have analytic solution for this normalization term. It's known as a beta function form. When we integrate from 0 to 1, it can be presented with gamma functions, which in case of integers happen to be same as factorial. And even then for the large integers, this can be challenging to compute, but this we can do. Later in the course, we have some other simple models where we have these normalization terms such that we have an analytic solution to them. But then soon we go to models where there's no analytic solutions and we need to solve these integrals otherwise, or in many cases, we just can avoid computing these integrals altogether when we compute the interesting expectations. And so we have now this posterior distribution. And here's an example how it can look like. So this is called beta distribution. So because it's so common, it has its own name. In this case, we have picked 6 redshifts in 10 trials. The model is the binomial model. We're using uniform prior. And for different theta values, we get then how likely that theta is. Of course, now if we really think about the bag of chips, this is approximation in that way that you can see that this I can have only finite number of chips here. So actually, the theta has to be then rational number. And here I've approximated as continuous, allowing also other possibilities. But then we will have cases also where it is reasonable to assume that the continuous theta, it's reasonable. So in this here, it's known as a beta distribution. So many software has then built-in functions to compute this beta density. And then that you would need to know that if you would use uniform prior, that in order to get this beta density, you will put in there number of red chips plus one and number of yellow chips plus one, and then you get the posterior distribution. So here's functions from R and Python you can use. And one of your exercises is also then to plot these beta distributions. And then later in the exercises, you also need to use these functions or other functions to plot these posterior distributions in R or Python. So this, one of the things we also look later in this posterior distribution is cumulative distributions. How much posterior mass there is until straight line point. And again, we come to the computational issues that there's no, not any more analytic solution for this. So the integral from 0 to 1, we had analytic solution, but from 0 to some other value between 0 and 1, there's no analytic solution. R uses this continued fraction with weighting factors and asymptotic expansion. Laplace did not know this, and this is also needs some computation. And Laplace, when he used binomial model, he developed normal approximation, also known as normal approximation, in order to be able to compute these cumulative density function values and posterior probabilities. This is example from the book, Placenta Previa. So the fetus has been attached in the wrong place. And then, based on the observations, it seems that this might affect then the sex ratio or the probability of girl birth. So we have these 437 girls and 543 boys. And then on the other hand, for lots of other data, we have this population average known, 0.485. And now we want to know whether this observed ratio, 0.445, in case of placenta previa, is different from the population average. So we can then, if we use uniform prior, we can use the beta distribution, plug in the values, we can plot the distribution, but we can also look at this from the posterior distribution. We can then compute 95% posterior interval, and the population average is not inside that, and we could also then compute what is the probability that the ratio is smaller than the population average. And we can see that there's some small chance that in the placenta previa also the sex ratio would be even larger than the population average, but it's also quite likely that it's clearly smaller. And that's it. And in the next clip, I'll talk about benefits of integration and predictive distributions.